There's so many great questions on Wednesday night that what we're going to do is we are going to continue our study on questions and answers from Wednesday night. So I'll tell you what, open your Bible to Genesis. Go to Genesis real quickly. I have to find my notes here. Well, Genesis is a good place, but I lied. Go to Matthew. Go to Matthew 16. We will get to Genesis in a little bit, and it is a good place to be. Also, if you, when you come in, just so you know, we have a real big coat rack, thanks to Brother James. If you run out of room where you're sitting, and that's why we did that, so that if you get a little claustrophobic with putting all your stuff around you, you're welcome to use that rack, as Brother Elvin is. So, Matthew chapter 16, and what we were talking about is, and we were talking about a couple of things. One of the things that came up was in some of the questions, and it's really interesting. Anytime you get into questions and answers, one question leads to another question, then you get off into some other stuff, and it's a lot of fun. Those that were here Wednesday night will remember that. But one of the things that we talked about that we got into a little bit, and there was a lot of buzz after church about it, so I thought, hey, if there's that much interest, I think maybe we'll revisit that subject. And that is the fact that when you get a glorified body, when you get raptured out of here, the body that you're going to have is going to be a sinless body. We all know that. We all know that. All right, but what does that mean in regards to the makeup of that body? Look at Matthew chapter number 16. Matthew chapter 16. I don't know about you, but you know, it's almost like if someone's like, "You want a new car?" You know, I'd want to know what that new car was like. You know, if it was a jalopy, I'd be like, "No thanks." I think we're in the jalopy right now, and God's going to give us the Mercedes in glory. Amen. That's how I look at it, but. But as, again, as far as the makeup of that body, what does it actually mean? So I want to look at a couple verses here as we get going into this. Matthew chapter 16, and look at verse number 17. And what we're going to talk about, starting this whole thing off, is that the glorified body, there's something that's not going to be there. And the thing that's not going to be there is the blood that you have flowing through your veins right now. Look at Matthew chapter 16, and look at verse number 16. This is after the Lord asked Simon Peter who he is, whom say ye that I am? And in verse 16, Simon Peter answered and said, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered and said unto him, "Blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and what? Blood hath not revealed unto thee." Now underline that. That's important. That's not a coincidence. That's not just a happenstance thing. You're going to see later on that the term flesh and bones is used throughout your Bible to also refer to a physical body. But this is different. All right, look at 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. You can have a body that is glorified, that is seen, and that can be touched and felt and handled. We're going to see that here in a little bit after the Lord came up from the dead. And he's the first fruits, that's what the Bible says. And those that are after him, that's us, will be like unto him. All right, so 1 Corinthians 15. And you say, what is this? This is real. This is some digging into your Bible, all right? This is going beyond some surface stuff, and I hope it's a blessing to you. I hope, hope you have a good time with it. Verse 50, this is talking about the resurrection. 1 Corinthians 15, the context is the resurrection. And in verse 50, the Bible says, "Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God." All right? Notice it says flesh and blood. So we're looking at revisiting these questions from Wednesday night, talking about the body you're going to have in glory, all right? Notice it in verse 50, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Let me ask you a question, guys. The kingdom of God. Now, this is a division in your Bible. You young people can sit in here, just so you know. We're going to keep Brother St. John's class in here. And then Miss Angie's class is downstairs, and Miss Ashley's obviously in there. Again, as it relates to the kingdom of God, think about this, guys. The kingdom of God, is it physical or is it spiritual? Spiritual, okay? So think about it like this. Jesus says, ye must be born again. Except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. He didn't say heaven, all right? And when they say, hey, where's the kingdom of God? Where's it at? How's it going to come? He says, look, it's not going to come with observation. You're not going to say, lo here or lo there, but rather the kingdom of God is within you, right? So when you get saved, you are automatically ushered into the kingdom of God. However, there's a part of you that hasn't been made right yet, and God is going to change it so you can exist in eternity with him. You say, what's that part of you? The old man, the flesh. And the thing that represents that flesh the best is the stuff you have flowing through your veins. All right? The Bible says the life of the flesh is in the blood. Look, if you would, at Galatians chapter 1. We're gonna sort of drive this thing into the ground. Galatians chapter number 1. Galatians chapter 1. Verse number 16. This is Paul's own testimony. And Paul's own testimony here, he's talking about, listen, when Jesus is asking Simon Peter who Jesus actually is, who do you men say that I am? Who do you think I am? And Simon answers the right way. He tells him, flesh and blood did not reveal it unto you. You say, why? Because flesh and blood is corrupt. And if you think about it, guys, in 1 Corinthians 15, there's a contrast when he talks about the rapture, where he talks about corruption putting on incorruption. Isn't that interesting? He talks about corruption, and then he talks about incorruption, and in there he says, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Why? Because the body you have right now cannot go there. All right? You literally implode. All right? This body's not made for that. And the thing that marks this body and the old man as it is in the sin nature is your blood. All right, look at Galatians 1, verse 16. This is Paul's own testimony. To reveal his son in me, that I might preach him among the heathen, immediately I conferred not with what? He didn't confer with man. He didn't confer with the old nature. He conferred with God. All right, he got with God to make sure this thing was right. So again, you're seeing that flesh and blood refers to man. All right, to the old nature of man. Look at Ephesians chapter number 6. Ephesians chapter number 6. This is one you ought to know pretty well. Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians chapter 6. We have, by the way, we have a couple folks joining our church this morning. Amen?
Amen.
That's a blessing. All right. So speaking of blood, they've got to offer their blood. Well, every time someone's visiting, they'll we're kidding. That's a joke. That's a joke. If this is on YouTube, just kidding. Ephesians chapter 6. Look at verse 12. For we wrestle not against what? You say, why? It's physical. And not just physical, but more so physical and as it relates to the natural realm. Okay? So he gives the contrast and he says, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. All right? Now look at Luke chapter 24. Luke chapter 24. I want to show you a couple things here about the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Luke chapter 24. Luke chapter 24. Now notice this is after the Lord Jesus Christ rose up from the dead. And you say, what did he do when he died on the cross? What did he shed from that cross to pay for your sins? He shed his blood. Matter of fact, that soldier comes by and says, just in case he hasn't spilled it all out. You know, we're a couple weeks away from Easter, man. You think about that. You read through that story, and there's some significance to the fact that he drives that spear into his side, and out flows what? Blood and water. Blood and water. All right? Look at Luke chapter 24, and look, if you would, at verse 36. And as they thus spake, Jesus himself stood in the midst of them. By the way, be careful what you're talking about. Jesus might show up. Amen? There they are talking. He shows up, and he says, peace be unto you. But they were terrified and affrighted and supposed that they had seen a, underline it, what? They thought they had seen a spirit, right? Look, if you would, at verse 38. He said to them, why are you troubled and why do thoughts arise in your hearts? Behold my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Handle me and see, for a spirit hath not what? Not flesh and blood. Flesh and bones. That's the thing. That's something to pay attention to. You say, why? Because he spilled his blood for you. And matter of fact, what's really interesting, go to John chapter number 20. John chapter number 20. John chapter number 20. And look, if you would, at verse number 17. This is when Mary realizes that Jesus is who he is. She calls him Rabboni, which is to say master. And the natural reaction of someone that loves Jesus Christ is to get as close to him as they can. Notice that. If you love the Lord, you're going to get as close to Him as you can. That's a natural reaction for someone that is trying to follow the Lord. And so she goes out to reach for Him. And what does He say in verse 17? Jesus saith to her, "Touch me not, for I have not yet ascended to my Father. But go to my brethren and say to them, I ascend unto my Father and your Father, and to my God and your God." Now think about that, guys. He rose up from the dead. He has not yet ascended. The Bible says, if you're a Bible believer, okay, here's what the Bible teaches. The Bible teaches that He went down into the lower parts of the earth, and that He preached to the souls that were in prison. In Ephesians chapter 4, said that He led captivity captive. All right, and He brought them out of the prison that they were waiting in. And the Catholics, they got the idea of purgatory. They got it wrong. All right, that's not a biblical thing. But I'll tell you what is biblical. In the Old Testament, people did not die and go straight to heaven. All right, you might have an exceptional case where Elijah swept up or something like that. But where someone's a type of the rapture, but for the most part, the Old Testament saints, when they died, you know where they went? According to Luke 16, they went to Abraham's bosom, which was in the heart of the earth. And there was a great gulf fixed between them that separated Abraham's bosom from hell. Isaiah says that hell hath enlarged herself, and I honestly believe that's a literal thing. And Jesus, when He goes down, He preaches to those souls, He brings them back up, and the Bible says that I think it's for 40 days, the bodies of them that slept arose and they walked around Jerusalem. You talk about a zombie, creepy, freak-out thing happening in Jerusalem. Here comes the Messiah. Not only is He up from the dead, but you know, there's King David, you know, and oh my goodness, Moses, and it's Abraham. What are they doing? You know, imagine, you know, some guy coming out of the dead is just sort of zombie-like, and everyone's going, "Who are you?" "I'm Abraham." "I'm Moses." You know, I mean, that's creepy stuff. That's Bible. Hollywood doesn't have anything on the Bible. Hollywood doesn't even come close to how... If you really get in your Bible, it's fascinating stuff. But think about this. He comes out of the grave, right? And He shows Himself to Mary, and He tells her, "Touch me not." Why is that? Because He could not be defiled with flesh and blood, because He'd already shed His holy blood. He's in a glorified body. He can't be defiled by that. Why? What's He about to do? He's about to present Himself to the Father. You can read about that in Hebrews chapter 9. And He presents Himself to the Father. And here's what's fascinating, guys. Look at chapter 20 and verse 1. "The first day of the week cometh Mary Magdalene early, when it was yet dark, unto the sepulchre, and seeth the stone taken away from the sepulchre." All right, guys, so you know what you find? The first of the week, early in the morning, there's Jesus revealing Himself to Mary. And He says to her in the morning, "Hey, don't touch me." All right, now I want you to look at the same chapter. Look down, if you would, at verse number, verse number 26. "And after 8 days, again His disciples were within, and Thomas with them. Then came Jesus, the doors being shut, and stood in the midst and said, Peace be unto you." Now, here's what's interesting, guys. That's 8 days after this event. However, I want you to go back, if you would, to verse number 19. So, Thomas gets it about a week later. He gets to talk with the Lord, and he gets things right with God. Amen? He starts off with, "Unless I get to..." You know, you ever met those people? They're real cynical. "Well, unless I see it for myself." And then God puts them in a situation where they get confronted with the Lord, and they go, "Okay, Lord, you're right." That's a good thing. You know, it's a lot better than seeing the right thing and still not acknowledging it. Some people do that. But think about this, guys. In verse 19, "Then the same day at evening, being the first day of the week." So, guys, in the morning, He reveals Himself to Mary, and He says, "Don't touch me." All right? That evening, He reveals Himself to His disciples, and look what He says here, verse 20. "When He had so said, He showed unto them His hands and His side. Then were the disciples glad when they saw the Lord." Now, guys, if He's showing them, you know what's probably happening? He's probably saying, "Hey, look." You know, it's Him, you know. And so here you have, within the same day, not even 24 hours, morning to evening, He's saying, "Look, check me out." Earlier in the same day, He's saying, "Don't touch me." You know what He did? He traveled millions of light years up to the third heaven and came back within the same day. Your body can't do that. We can barely do that with NASA's help, right? And here you have the glorified body of Jesus Christ. You say, "What do you think is missing?" "I don't think there's any blood there." He says, "Flesh and bones, the spirit hath not flesh and bones, as you see me have." All right? Now think about this, guys. Look at verse 19 again. Then the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were what? Jesus stood in the midst. Now, you know what you have there? You've got a supernatural body with no blood. And you know what it can do? It can walk through walls. You say, what is that? Go back to Joel chapter 2. Go to your Old Testament. When the Bible describes the army that's going to come with the Lord during the Battle of Armageddon, he describes an army that the world has never seen the likes of. Now, guys, I'll tell you what. I've watched some of the Spetsnaz stuff, the Russian Special Forces. I've educated, read some stuff on Navy SEALs. I've read some stuff on, believe it or not, even the Air Force has Special Forces. Hi, Air Force guys. I'm just kidding. But I tell you what, it's fascinating stuff what the militaries of this world are able to accomplish, and it really is. But the army you're about to read about, there's no army like this one on this earth. Look at Joel chapter 2 and look at verse 1. Blow ye the trumpet in Zion and sound an alarm in my holy mountain. Let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord cometh, for it is nigh at hand, a day of darkness and of gloominess, a day of clouds and of thick darkness. All right? If you woke up this morning in a bad mood, can I say this? Your face should not resemble Joel 2 verse 1, okay? All right, a day of thickness and, you know, thick darkness and gloominess, all right? But that day, when he comes to exact vengeance and judgment on the earth, it will be that. Now, I want you to read about the army that comes with him. Look at verse number 7. They shall run like mighty men. They shall climb the wall like men of war. They shall march everyone on his ways. They shall not break their ranks. Neither shall one thrust another. There's no friendly fire involved. You know, there's no military on the face of the earth that's never experienced that. Every military has experienced friendly fire, which is sort of an oxymoron, because when you get hit, it ain't friendly. Amen? But the truth is, he's saying, look, this is it. You know what he's saying? This is a perfect army. And look what he goes on to say. He says, verse 8, when they fall upon the sword, they shall not be wounded. Can you imagine that? The armies of the Antichrist, and you just boom, boom. I mean, that's weird stuff, but it's what the Bible says, isn't it? I mean, think about it, guys. What Hollywood wants to imitate is what's in this book. All right, I think young men like this stuff. Man, I can't wait to get in. You know, every guy, every man in this room has at some point dreamed about someone shooting him, and he just runs through it. You know, I think the worst nightmare for every man is when he's in a fight in a dream and he goes to punch someone, it's like Jell-O. You ever had that happen, guys? Oh my goodness, that's the worst thing in the world. Back to Joel chapter 2. Look what it says here, verse 9. They shall run to and fro in the city. They shall run upon the wall. They shall climb up upon the houses. They shall enter in at the windows like a thief. There's that thief in the night. There's the second advent. The earth shall quake before them. You say, what is that? That is an army that is made up of supernatural bodies. You say, what's missing? Flesh and blood. The blood's gone. Now, they've got a body. The body's there. It's flesh and bones. The makeup is there, similar to your physical body. Think about this. When God made Adam, he made Adam in the image of who? God, right? But the thing that made God man was him taking on this flesh, and in this flesh, he had flesh and blood. All right. The difference is he never sinned. Never sinned. All right. Now, under every testament, we're going to look at this right now, but under every testament, do you know what's commanded for us not to do? Now, there are certain things in the Old Testament that don't apply today. All right. Let me give you one. You do not have to observe the Sabbath. You don't. Is it a good idea to take? Could you spiritually apply Exodus, you know, chapter 20 to observe the Sabbath and say, okay, on Sundays we try to rest? Nothing wrong with that. But to say that you are to observe the Sabbath, guys, I'm sorry, it's not in the New Testament. You don't have to do that, all right? That said, there are certain things that transcend dispensation. Genesis chapter, you don't have to look there now, but Genesis chapter 9, all right? Leviticus chapter number, I believe it's 15. Let me see my notes here. Genesis 9, Leviticus 17, and Acts chapter 15. Three places. Acts 15 is New Testament. In every one of those places, you know, he says, don't drink blood. Don't drink blood. There's something, you know, there's something about, you know, staying away from blood. When the Jews were told to make their meat, they were told, you take your meat and you take the blood and you put it over here, you don't eat the blood, right? And the Lord is real particular about that. And you may think, well, why is that? There's something about it. There's something about it. Look at Genesis chapter number 2. Genesis chapter 2, there's something about the blood that's peculiar, and I think the Lord is saying, look, there's something about it that's defiled, all right? It flows in you, it's part of your makeup, but you are not to consume it. Matter of fact, next Sunday we're going to talk about the cup of devils and the cup of the Lord in Sunday school. And we're going to, you say, why are we doing that? Because we're doing the Lord's Supper next Sunday. And I'd like you to understand why we don't believe that the body and blood of Jesus Christ is physically present when we take part of the Lord's Supper. All right, we don't believe that as Bible-believing Christians. It amazes me at how many Catholic traditions are coming into the church today. I hear of Christians that around this time of year, I'm giving up meat for Lent. I mean, saved born-again people, I don't doubt their salvation. I'm going, where'd you get that from? Where'd that come from? Just and you know what it is? The music, the Christian bookstores, everything's all just sort of into the same thing. All right? But look, if you would, at Genesis chapter number 2. Genesis chapter number 2. And we got onto this as well. So where did the blood come from? Now, I'm going to give you my synopsis on the thing, and I'm not going to fight you to the death if you think I'm wrong. I'm not going to teach it as doctrine necessarily. But if I had to, if you put a gun to my head, theologically speaking, okay, and you say, where does the blood come from and why are we defiled? I would say one of two things. Either Adam had pure blood, and when he took part of that fruit, it defiled him, defiled the blood, or he had a body that didn't have blood. And I'll let you study the thing out and come to your own conclusion on it. I can tell you this, a glorified body, the one you're going to have in the resurrection, doesn't have blood. I'll tell you that much. All right? Look, if you would, at Genesis chapter number 2. Now, you know what this is? Some of you go, why does this stuff matter? Do you ever think about where this stuff comes from? I mean, if God puts some of this stuff in the Bible, he puts it there for a reason. And I will tell you what's happened to so many Christians is, well, tell me how this is going to apply to my family practically. I'll tell you how it's going to apply to your family or apply to your job or apply to anything else. The more truth you have in your life, the more truth you know from that book, the better Christian, the better father, the better wife, the better servant in this church, the better kid, the better everything you're going to be. All right? Genesis chapter 2, look at verse number 8. And the Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden. There he put the man whom he had formed. And out of the ground made the Lord God to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food. Now, underline that. You know what happens in chapter 3? Eve is tempted. You know what she's tempted with? Two out of those three things. You know what that tells you? Two out of the three things that Eve is tempted with are not necessarily wrong. They're not. Guys, God made us to look at food and go, yum. All right? You know, somebody was, my daughter was like, what should I name my goat? I said, Stew, S-T-E-W. You know, God made us to look at food and go, man, that's good for food. And he says, it's also, look at in verse 9, the trees were pleasant to the sight. Guys, I'll tell you what, it's not so much that these things are bad, it's about how they come in your life. All right? If you're married, you know what you ought to do? That looks good. Amen? That ought to be how you look at the other person, all right? I love when someone goes, well, I don't think, you know, the physical outward beauty matters. You're a liar. You're a liar. You were attracted to some, you know, whoever you're married to or whatever. Listen, I know this, all right? These beautiful young couple is going to get married soon. Everybody go, aww. All right? And I can tell you this. When they first saw each other, it wasn't like, wow, they have a wonderful spirit. I'm sure they were like, wow, good-looking guy, good-looking gal. And then you develop things from there that can't just be the only thing. Amen. Because someday, you know, she's going to take off the eyelashes and take out the teeth and take out. Oh, yeah, we're all going to head there someday. And you better pray that there's something beyond the surface, all right? But what I'm getting at is this. I'm getting at, don't worry, bro, it's going to be a long time. It'll be a long time, all right? Medini is like, I don't know, why did I come to the church today? but here's the point. Two out of those three things aren't necessarily bad in and of themselves. God made you that way. The problem is two things. Why does something appeal to you? And secondly, the last temptation that Eve had was she saw the tree was desirous. It was one that was desirous to make one wise. It was a pride thing. You take pleasant to the eyes and good for food, the carnal appetite, and you mix it with pride, and you are in trouble. Now, that said, the Lord makes these trees, and he makes them pleasant to the sight and good for food. The tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Now, you know what's interesting? I always hear people say, you know, I talk to an atheist, and they're like, well, why did God put the tree right in the middle of the garden if he didn't want them to have it? First off, it doesn't say he did that with the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Read your Bible. It says he did it with the tree of life. Read it. That's what it says. All right? Now, that said, I want you to think about this. What are these trees associated with? Now, I'm going to give you something that I honestly believe. Look at Judges chapter 9. Judges chapter 9. We're going to fly through this as we're probably, I'm probably burning too much time on this one question. Judges chapter number 9. I see that look, Lacey. My wife is always like, uh-huh, he does that. He always makes the first point really long. Judges chapter 9. Judges, we've been married 17 years. Hallelujah. Almost 17 years. Almost 17 years. Judges chapter 9. Look, if you would, at, won't read all of these things, won't read the whole chapter here, but look at verse 8. The trees went forth on a time to anoint a king over them, and they said unto the olive tree, reign thou over us. Now, it's a parable that has to do with Abimelech and Jerubbaal. We're not going to read all that right now, but here's the point. There's trees mentioned in this passage, and they're associated with something. All right, look at verses 8 and 9. You say, what do you have? You have the olive tree. Now, do you know what the olive tree is connected with? It's connected with life and the Holy Spirit. You say, how's that? Well, I'm going to give you a couple things to think about. In the Old Testament, they're told to take that pure olive oil and beat it for the lamps that would bring light in the tabernacle. All right, let me give you this as well. In Genesis chapter 8, just take, if you're taking notes, notice what happens. The dove is sent out from Noah's ark, and what does that dove do? It brings back in its beak a twig from what? An olive branch. You know what that olive branch is saying? There's life. All right. When they anointed a king in the Old Testament, they would take olive oil and they would anoint that king, and that was a picture of the Holy Spirit being over that king and God's blessing and God's hand and the life from the Holy Spirit of God being on that person, God calling them into that ministry, if you want to use that term. All right, the olive tree is connected with oil, which is connected with the Holy Spirit and life. All right, if you think about it, go to Romans chapter number 11 real quickly. Romans chapter 11. When the Lord is talking about us as Gentiles, you know what he says? He says that you're like a wild olive tree. And you're grafted into this other tree, the nation of Israel. All right, look at Romans chapter 11. Romans chapter 11, and look at verse 17. If some of the branches be broken off, and thou being a wild olive tree, wert grafted in among them, and with them partakest of the root and fatness of the olive tree, there's life. You know what you were before you were saved? You were dead. And he takes you, and he grafts you into that olive tree, and you are connected. You say, what are you connected to? You are connected to that olive tree, but you know what's at the root of that tree? Jesus Christ himself. That's where your life is found. I am the vine, you're the branches, right? So you're brought into that thing. All right, so that olive tree, and if you look down at verses, look at verse 26, so all Israel shall be saved. Who are they? The olive tree. And he says, look, you're grafted into them, and all Israel shall be saved. What is the connection? The connection is with life, the Holy Spirit and salvation, all right? Now, I won't teach it as a doctrine, but if someone asks me, what tree do you think that tree of life is or is connected with, I would say an olive tree. I would say an olive tree. Think about this. Judges chapter 9, go back there real quickly. Judges chapter 9. There's a lot more references to the olive tree connected with life. I just gave you a couple things to chew on. Judges chapter 9. Look at verse 10. The tree said to the fig tree, come thou and reign over us. But the fig tree said to them, should I forsake my sweetness and my good fruit and go to be promoted over the trees? That fig tree, think about it, guys. What's the first thing you read about the fig tree in the Bible? Genesis 3, after they sinned, what do? They took fig leaves and they sewed them together and they put them as aprons, as a covering. You know what it is? It's a picture of self-righteousness. All right? The fig tree is a picture of righteousness or self-righteousness. It's the only tree in the Bible that Jesus goes by and curses. There's something to it. All right? You're not going to get salvation through your own righteousness. Amen? You got to get grafted in. You can't sew your own apron. All right? And so you know what God has to do in the garden? Think about it. Think about it, guys. He says, your fig tree is not enough to cover you. I'm going to kill a lamb, and I'm going to clothe you with the skins of this animal so you can be covered the right way. What had to happen? Blood had to be shed by an innocent animal, sort of like Jesus Christ dying for your sins. All right? So that fig tree is connected with righteousness or self-righteousness. Look at Judges 9, verse 14. Then said all the trees under the bramble, come thou and reign over us. And the bramble said unto the trees, so on and so forth. You say, what's the bramble? It's thorns. Think about the first time thorns are mentioned in the Bible, Genesis chapter 3, verse 17 and 18. It's connected with the curse of the ground. And you know what that thorn, that bramble tree is connected with? It's connected with the curse and the atonement for that curse. You say, what did Jesus Christ wear on his head when he was crucified? Crown of thorns. What was man cursed with? Those thorns and those thistles that would come out of the ground. You say, what is that? It's connected with the curse and connected with the atonement for the sin for that curse. Now look at verses 12 and 13, same passage. I left this for the last for a reason. Then said the trees unto the vine, wait a minute, I didn't know a vine was a tree. It is in the Bible. It is in the Bible. God calls it a vine tree. We're going to look at that here in a little bit. But these trees are talking to trees. So far, I mean, we can agree, right? Olive tree, all right? We're talking about the fig tree. We're talking about brambles and a cursed tree, if you will. And then he talks to the vine, like it's a tree. And he says to the vine, come down and reign over us, so on and so forth. Now, guys, think about this. Look at Numbers chapter number 6. Numbers chapter number 6. He calls it a tree here. When he's talking about and giving description for the Nazarites and the vows that they would take, look at Numbers chapter 6. Numbers chapter 6 and look at verse 4. Now, if you're sort of going, I'm not getting all this, if you write the notes down, go back and read through it. Some of the dots that we're connecting right now, you're going, I'm not sure if I'm connecting all of them, all right? Go back and read through them yourself. Numbers chapter 6, look at verse 4. All the days of his separation shall he eat nothing that is made of the vine, what? Is your Bible the final authority in all matters of faith and practice? So if the Bible defines a vine as a tree, can you call it a tree? I think so. Matter of fact, God does, so I think it's a good idea to do that. Now, look at Deuteronomy chapter 32. Deuteronomy 32. I'm trying to make the case for the fact that I believe, honestly, that if we're to talk about that tree in the garden being something that we look at today and understand today, that all through the Bible is something that's connected with something that can turn bad. I mean, if it's new grape juice, it's okay. But if it sits out for a long time, you get in trouble. Just read Genesis chapter 9. First time someone gets drunk in the Bible, bad things happen. You say, what was Noah after the flood? He has a vineyard. And he drinks wine, old wine. He gets drunk, some bad stuff happens. All right? That connotation is found throughout the Bible for the rest of the Bible. What's it connected with? The vine tree. Look at Deuteronomy chapter 32 and look, if you would, at verse number 14. Butter of kine. There's only one fruit in the Bible that's ever mentioned as having blood. Only one. You're about to read it. All right? Butter of kine and milk of sheep with fat of lambs and rams of the breed of Bashan and goats with the fat of kidneys of wheat. And thou didst drink the pure blood of the what? I'll give you $1 million if you can find any other fruit in the Bible that's mentioned as having blood. You say, you don't have $1 million, Pastor. You're right. I can tell you this. There's no other fruit in the Bible that's mentioned as having blood. That's it. Now, why would God point out that that fruit has blood? Over there in Proverbs, when he talks about someone getting drunk, you know what he says? Who hath woe? Who hath sorrow? Who hath contentions? Who hath babbling? Who hath wounds without cause? Who hath redness of eyes? You ever looked at your eye? Ever look at your look at that? Someone one time, there's a guy named Brian Solomon. He's a hoot, man. If you ever get to meet Brian Solomon, this guy is from Alabama. He was like a Southern Jim Carrey. He does all kinds of funny things with his faces. I went to Bible school with him. And one time we're working, I goes, boy, man, I wish I had your veins, brother. I said, what are you talking about? You're so vascular. I said, what do you mean, man? I'm creaked out right now. But he's talking about that, you know. And you look at that, you say, what is it? It looks like a vine. That's phenomenal, isn't it? Now, where'd that come from? Moses curses the water by turning it into blood. Jesus takes the water and turns it into wine. The first sign there with Moses and Pharaoh, that water to blood, that's a picture of something. You know what happens in the tribulation? The water turns to blood and everything in the sea dies. You say, why? It's defiled. All right? I believe, guys, that one of two things, either Adam didn't have blood when he started off, and or he had blood and it got defiled. But that's the deal with the blood. Now, I didn't want to go through all the verses because next week we're going to look at some of these that have to do with old wine and new wine. So we'll talk about that more next week. Now, somebody else asked a question about, are we healed through his stripes? Look at Isaiah chapter 53. You ever heard someone say that verse, by his stripes you're healed? Nothing. I mean, it's a Bible verse. There's nothing wrong with it. But let me ask you this, guys. Do you believe that we should conquer the world today through armed battle? Christians, you think Christians should? I mean, you know what the Crusades was about? The Crusades was a pope basically telling everybody, okay, guys, we need to take Jerusalem and claim it for the Christian church, and by so doing, we will usher in the kingdom. Right? That's what he said. And so you know what thousands of men from Europe did? They marched off to their death thinking that if they did this in the name of God, in this sign conquer, all right, they would be ushered into heaven. Can you think of another religion that looks at things that way today? Islam, right? And so they have this thing called jihad. You see, what's the problem? They're onto something. They know that the only way to make the earth right is through a dictatorship. The problem is none of them have a perfect dictator to offer. You've got one. Now listen, you're someday, you know what you're going to do? You're going to come back and you're going to fight the armies of this world. That's not your job right now. All right? So if you take something that's biblical and you apply it before the time, you can make a mess of things, right? Look at Isaiah 53 and look at verse number 1. Isaiah 53 and verse 1. Now, all this has to do with the coming of Jesus Christ, who hath believed our report, and to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed. For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant. That's Jesus growing up before God the Father as a tender plant. And as a root, he's the root and offspring of David. Out of a dry ground, he hath no form nor comeliness. And when we shall see him, there's no beauty that we should desire him. All right? He didn't show up as, you know, a male model like a lot of the movies present Jesus Christ, you know. He wasn't a soft man. He's a carpenter, and he wasn't, an eye pleaser. The Bible says he's despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. Thank God that he was. He took our griefs on him. Amen. It says, we hid as it were our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Thank God for that. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. You believe that? He was bruised for our iniquity. You believe that? His chastisement, the chastisement of our peace was upon him. You believe that? All right. And with his stripes we are healed. Do you believe that? I believe that too. Here's the problem. Let me tell you how a lot of Christians apply that today. If you're sick, all right, just remember he died so that you wouldn't be sick. Now again, you know what that is? That's a half-truth. Someday you're going to be in a body, amen? And the reason you're going to be in that glorified body is because of what he did when he was on the cross. And so you will receive your healing in a glorified body. However, that does not mean that that applies right now. All right? Look at Isaiah 53, look at verse 12. Let me give you another example of this, all right? Therefore will I divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong. You know what a spoil is? After battle, all right, when you beat somebody, all right, when you beat somebody in a battle, you go in and say, okay, I want that, and I want that, and I want that. Thank you very much. That's the consequences of losing, all right? I know this is hard to understand in today's society, but there are winners and there are losers in battles, all right? Someone wins, someone loses, all right? And so here's the thing. God is promising the Son all these promises, and he's saying, look, someday you're going to divide your spoil with the great. You're going to take your spoil from the strong. And what a wonderful thing that is. Here's a question. Did Jesus do that? Not physically. He did it spiritually. The Bible says he spoiled principalities and powers in Colossians chapter 2 when he rose up from the dead. That's a spiritual thing, but guess what? It applies physically at the second coming. You know what happens with this healing business? The same thing. Look at Romans chapter number 8. Go over there real quickly. Romans chapter 8. You don't receive your healing. That's why when I hear people talk like that, here's the other problem. Okay, so here's the thing. If I'm a saved, born-again child of God, and I do have sickness, and by His stripes I'm healed, then maybe the problem is just my faith, or there's sin in my life, and this is the problem with that line of thinking, is that God wants you to be healthy, wealthy, and wise all the time. You know, and let me tell you something, that is not, guys, if that's the case, can you please explain to me, Trophimus, I have left at Miletum sick. Paul, can you please explain to me when Paul says, thrice I besought the Lord that he would take away this thorn in the flesh, and you know what God's answer was? My grace is sufficient for thee. God didn't say, Isaiah 53 verse 12, by my stripes you're healed, Paul. You just got to claim it. You don't have enough faith. You know what he said? It's good for you to have this affliction in your body. When you start thinking that, listen, I'm not saying, I understand, you do have a couple of spots in the Bible where the Lord addresses, I think there's a John chapter 5, a man was born blind, and the disciple says, who did sin, this man or his parents? You know what Jesus says? Neither. This was done that God might be glorified. However, there is a place where a guy couldn't walk. He was a cripple, and the Lord tells him, rise up and walk. You guys remember the We Sing songs? He was jumping and leaping and praising God. Come on. Okay, all right. All right, nobody understands. But that was my childhood, right? He was jumping and leaping and praising God in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Rise up and walk. And so here's this guy. You know what the Lord tells him when he meets him later? You know what he tells him? Go and sin no more. You know what that tells you? His issue was connected with sin. You know, the Bible does say the wages of sin is death, right? I mean, you live a life of a fornicator, you know, you might wake up with someday a disease, right? Okay, so here's my thing, though. There are many, many times, and the majority of times when people are sick, say people, you know what they're dealing with? The curse of just living in a physical body. And quit trying to spiritualize it all the time. Sometimes there's nothing spiritual to it. You know what you got? You got a bug. You say, why? Because it's around you. You say, what do I do to get rid of it? Live with it. I know. A bunch of us have been sick. You know, for the last, you say, some of you are going, a bunch of us? Pastor, you have been sick. You're right. I got one or two days, and that was enough for me. I didn't want any more, all right? But there's been a lot of sickness going around. You know what I want you guys to understand? Some of that stuff's just life. We don't need to spiritualize it. You say, why? Because people over-spiritualize some of these things. I'm not saying sometimes there's not a spiritual element to it, but more times than not, it's just life. And the Lord understands that, look, He's told us, you're going to be living in this body. It's going to be that way. Now, I believe in taking care of yourself. I believe in doing what you can to take care of yourself and to guard against sickness and all that. I'm not saying throw caution to the wind. I'm just saying when you've done everything and you get sickness, don't go, oh, God, what's going on? Sometimes you're just sick. Amen. And that's just part of life. Now look at Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8 and look at verse 19. For the good that I would not... that's chapter 7. That's a good one too. Romans 8 verse 19. For the earnest expectation of the creature waiteth for the manifestation of the sons of God. Underline sons of God and write a reference there to 1 John chapter 3 where it says, Beloved, it doth not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when we shall see him, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And it talks about us being called the sons of God in that passage, right? But look at verse 20. For the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who has subjected the same in hope. That's Adam. Because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of what? Corruption. You know what he's talking about? When we, it's in two parts. You experience it at the rapture. The rest of creation experiences it when Jesus Christ comes back to establish his kingdom on the earth. You know what it talks about in Isaiah? A little kid, I saw a picture one time, I'll never forget it. It's a little kid skipping down the street. He's got a leash in his hand. He's walking with a leopard on one hand and a lion on the other. You say, what is that? That's spoken of in Isaiah. A little child shall lead them, the Bible says. Can you imagine you walking, you're just looking down the street and seeing a little kid skipping down the street and he's got a little lion next to him. You know, some, wrong dispensation, we're good. You know, I mean, that's how the thing's going to go. You say, why? Because we're going to be delivered from the bondage of corruption. All right, but it's part of the human experience. It really is. That said, we're running out of time, so we're going to go ahead and stop there. We might continue this the next time, not next week, but maybe the Sunday after that. as far as questions and answers. There were two more really good, and one was about mystery of iniquity, the other one was about rightly dividing the Word of God. I will say this, in a nutshell, about rightly dividing the Word of God. If you don't do that, the Bible is full of contradictions. I just read you one in Isaiah chapter 53 and verse 12, where it says he divided his spoil with the strong. He didn't do that. He's going to when he comes back. All right? He hasn't done that yet. So if you don't rightly divide where things go, then you end up with contradictions. So now I know I just went, boom, right? And so if some of the stuff went over your head, I hope you took notes. You can look at it later. Before we go to the Lord in prayer, does anyone have, I'm scared to ask, anyone have a question about what we just discussed?